Part 1. Upon a time, before the fairy broods drove nymph and satyr from the prosperous woods, before King Oberon's bright diadem, scepter, and mantle, clasped with dewy gem, frighted away the dryads and the fawns from rushes green and brakes and cowslipped lawns, the ever-smitten Hermes, empty, left his golden throne, bent warm on amorous theft. From high Olympus had he stolen light on this side of Jove's clouds, to escape the sight of his great summoner, and made retreat into a forest on the shores of Crete. For somewhere in that sacred island dwelt a nymph, to which all hoofed satyrs knelt, at whose white feet the languid tritons poured pearls, while on land they withered and adored. Fast by the springs where she to bathe was wont, and in those meads where sometimes she might haunt, were strewn rich gifts, unknown to any muse, though fancy's casket were unlocked to choose. Ah, what a world of love was at her feet, so Hermes thought, and a celestial heat burnt from his winged heels to either ear, that from a whiteness, as the lily clear blushed into roses mid his golden hair, fallen in jealous curls about his shoulders bare. From vale to vale, from wood to wood, he flew, breathing upon the flowers his passion knew, and wound with many a river to its head, to find where this sweet nymph prepared her secret bed. In vain, the sweet nymph might nowhere be found, and so he rested on the lonely ground, pensive, and full of painful jealousies of the wood gods, and even the very trees. There, as he stood, he heard a mournful voice, such as one heard in gentle heart destroys all pain but pity. Thus the lone voice spake, "When from this wreathed tomb shall I awake? When move in a sweet body fit for life and love and pleasure, and the ruddy strife of hearts and lips? Oh, miserable me!" The god, dove-footed, glided silently round bush and tree, soft-brushing in his speed the taller grasses and full-flowing weed, until he found a palpitating snake, bright and cirque-couchant in a dusky brake. She was a Gordian shape, of dazzling hue, vermilion-spotted, golden, green, and blue, striped like a zebra, freckled like a pard, eyed like a peacock, and all crimson-barred, and full of silver moons, that as she breathed, dissolved, or brighter shone, or interwreathed their lustres with the gloomier tapestries. So, rainbow-sided, touched with miseries she seemed, at once some pinnacled lady elf, some demon's mistress, or the demon's self. Upon her crest she wore a wannish fire sprinkled with stars, like Ariadne's tiara. Her head was serpent, but ah, bitter sweet. She had a woman's mouth with all its pearls complete, and for her eyes, what could such eyes do there but weep, and weep, that were born so fair, as Proserpine still weeps for her Sicilian heir. Her throat was serpent, but the words she spake came as through bubbling honey, for love's sake. And thus, while Hermes on his pinions lay, like a stooped falcon ere he take his prey, "Fair Hermes, crowned with feathers, fluttering light, I had a splendid dream of thee last night. I saw thee sitting on a throne of gold among the gods, upon Olympus, old, the only sad one. For thou didst not hear the soft, lute-fingered muses chanting clear, nor even Apollo when he sang alone, deaf to his throbbing throat's long, long, melodious moan. I dreamt I saw thee, robed in purple flakes, break amorous through the clouds, as morning breaks, and swiftly as a bright Phoebean dart, strike for the Cretan isle, and here thou art."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.